Hello there. Good afternoon. Magandang hapon po. Welcome to BIOMIN Philippines webinar. My name is Ronel Garcia, Marketing and Business Development Manager of BIOMIN Philippines, and I am your moderator this afternoon. So isa pong mainit na hapon mula po sa aming office in Ortigas. So today, we will explore a very interesting topic, especially now that we are under a new normal. So we will discuss the nutrient sparing and how it can optimize our feed value and animal performance. We are joined by our featured expert, Dr. Neil Gannon. So before I introduce our speaker, I'd like to remind our live audience with three things. So first, this is an interactive webinar. You can ask questions on the chat function at the toolbar, and we will read your questions at the end of the presentation of the speaker. Usually, the toolbar is on the right side of your screen. Second reminder, since this is an interactive presentation, there are poll questions. There are two poll questions. On each question, you can choose answer that best fit your scenario, and we will use your answers as a point of discussion with our speaker. And lastly, I would like to remind everybody that at the end of the webinar, there is a post survey form that we encourage everybody to take so we could know how we will improve this support to you. So without further ado, let me read a short background there about the speaker. Our speaker was born in Sydney, Australia, and completed his Bachelor of Agricultural Science with honors and PhD in pig nutrition at the University of Sydney, and was a postdoctoral fellow at the Baylor College of Medicine in Houston, Texas, USA. After returning to Australia, he continued his interest in animal nutrition, working in government and commercial feed milling organizations, and as senior lecturer at the University of Queensland. In 2011, Neil joined BIOMIN Australia, where he was the managing director, before commencing his role in 2015 as regional product manager, gut performance. In this role, he works with the BIOMIN research teams in Austria to develop innovative solutions for the challenges facing livestock producers, and then assist BIOMIN staff and customers in the Asian region to optimize pig, poultry, and ruminant productivity and profitability using the phytogenic, microbial, and acid solutions. So I am honored to introduce Dr. Neil Gannon. Neil, we are fortunate to have you this afternoon.
Thank you very much, Ron. Thank you for the kind words. And good morning, good afternoon, good evening to all of our international participants, and particularly to those in the Philippines. As Ron introduced, this is the title I will work through. And the overview today, I would like to discuss in detail things about the drivers of efficiency in animal nutrition, the interaction between feed formulation and gut health, for example, and the relationship between nutrient specifications and feed costs. But also, as the title indicates, I'd like to introduce the concept of nutrient sparing and identify why designing diets optimizing gut efficiency could be better than using some of the safety margin approaches that formulators and nutritionists currently employ. Then I have a couple of quick examples of implementing nutrient sparing approaches, recognizing we're a little bit time short to go through all of these topics in detail, but hopefully along the way we'll identify why a matrix, as is used commonly with enzymes, is not an applicable approach when using some of these nutrient sparing approaches. And obviously it's BIOMIN's seminar, and we'll use some of the BIOMIN solutions for nutrient sparing and gut optimization. As Ron introduced, there's questions are welcome at any time via the chat function. One of the introductory comments is really in terms of using feed additives and looking at your performance, if we assume that the performance is this green line in the middle, depending on what your objectives are, can have a big impact on how you use feed additives, whether you're looking at to improve your performance, whether by taking those feed additives out, you would drop down in performance, so you therefore use feed additives to prevent a performance drop. Or in some cases, performance may be down at this level, and then you need to get back up onto this performance line. And so often we can use the same additive, but in each of these three different regions, depending on what our performance objectives are. And this is where it gets a little bit complicated as to how you should apply feed additives and any other strategy in your business. Very briefly, we know that there's many things that influence feed efficiency, and these are genetics, environment, housing, staff, biosecurity, hygiene, and disease status, and how often these impacts are not optimal or have particularly in types of disease, how often we have a disease outbreak, and what the effect of our control programs are. And just as a reminder for those in this audience, these slides will be shared with you after the presentation. So happy to share all this information. And then in terms of feed efficiency, and again, where we're sitting here today is most of us are in the nutrition side. And if feeding has an impact on whether we have intake aspects, the digestibility and availability of the nutrients in those feeds, and the choice of what ingredients and nutrients we actually use to make up those feeds. So you can see there's many things that impact feed efficiency. And as much as the feed guys would like to think it's feeding is the main driver, you can have the best feed in the world, but if all these other parameters are not optimal, then the feed will not perform to its expectation. But more importantly, when we look at all these drivers, these are the same drivers that have an impact on gut health. And so we have to be conscious when we're moving forward in terms of understanding animal performance, what the impacts on gut health are. And I'd like to introduce, again, very briefly, unfortunately with time limitations, but some of the four key components of gut health. Obviously, microbiota, both the beneficial guys as well as the pathogenic ones, and importantly, how we actually get the right microbiota when the bird or the piglet is first born. And in the mothering environment, in the farrowing shed of sows, then obviously the piglet gets exposed to mum. But in modern hatcheries, those microbiota that mum would normally have and share when the chick hatches doesn't occur. And so we have some strategies around application of probiotics in the hatchery to try and optimize this microbiota right from the start. Intestinal integrity is also very important because we want to make sure that the gut is fluid enough to absorb nutrients, but strong enough to not to have any detrimental impacts, and particularly of microbes going through. And there's a whole lot of areas around mucus composition, the impact of endotoxins, mycotoxins on intestinal integrity. But in terms of the discussion today, what I really want to focus on is the mucosal immune system. And we know that the mucosal immune system is of the gastrointestinal tract is the largest immune organ in the body. There are a number of different types of cells, lymphocytes, macrophages, dendritic cells, and many others all working together to protect the gut from disease and excess inflammatory reactions. And we know that immunity responses can be quick, not necessarily very specific, called the innate immunity system, or we can have slower and longer term, but very specific actions. And this is the acquired, which is what we get through the likes of vaccinations. And our aim whenever we're looking at the immune system is to ensure that there's an adequate immunity response without overstimulation, because all of these immune responses consume enormous amounts of energy and amino acids. And if we overstimulate the immune system or allow it to be overstimulated, then the animal has now going to lose energy and amino acids from productive purposes because it's trying to fight or mount an immune response. And so when we look at all these things together, they occur in different parts of the gut, whether it's the lamina propria or the mesentery. And when we put all these three factors together, the microbiota, the intestinal integrity, and the mucosal immune system, you can see that they all work quite interlinked in a nice jigsaw puzzle. And so we can't have good gut health without any one of these three particular factors. And the final one in the four ideas is the intestinal morphology. And this refers to the correct shape, height, and function of the mucosal cells. And all of this is vital for nutrient absorption. So if we consider the different additives that might be in the market, we could have antibiotics, we could have antibiotic growth promoters, carbohydrate, protein, enzymes, etc. And if I take the four components of gut health that I referred to and make a bit of a rough scoring system, you can see that different feed additives will have a different impact on their contribution to the microbiota, the role of gut integrity, the importance of the mucosal immune system, and optimizing intestinal morphology. And this is why when we see the use of feed additives, individually one feed additive may be very effective. However, combinations often result in better overall gut health because there is a synergism that can occur. And when we're trying to look at gut health, it's really important to know what your enemy is so that you can apply the most effective strategy in terms of the feed additives that are available to you to try and address what is one of the four challenges to your gut health. So the question is often asked, what is the best diet formulation for my animals? Well, unfortunately, there's a big depends here. And one of the difficulties is that what is your measure of animal performance and or your financial success? And different companies, different individuals have different measures. So it's very difficult to say what is the best diet formulation. And similarly, it's really dependent on how confident are you with the nutrient values in your raw materials? How regularly do you test them? How much variation is there actually in the ultimate raw material through the growing conditions? And this is where I want to talk about in a second about the variability. We know, and I won't spend any time on these, and this is just an example of cob for broilers, but we know very precisely what the nutrient requirements are of different animals at different ages of growth, through to the lysine ratios, amino acids, energy. And similarly for an example of pigs, again, we know quite precisely what we need to feed to. And we can go out to 6 or 7 decimal places if you really want to be that precise. But the problem is that when we start looking at the performance to an animal under real life with different nutrient levels, it becomes a real mess. And this is what it can look like. And I'll just step through what each of these lines mean. The big black line through the center ascending is our feed cost. And we know that if we look at nutrient level at the bottom, as we increase nutrient level, so will our feed costs go up. Along the way, as we increase the nutrient level, the animal will have can increase its nutrient intake if it is allowed to, it doesn't reach gut capacity. And presumably, if the nutrient intake is balanced, the weight gain will also have an increased pattern. Ideally, feed intake will tend to decline, particularly in broilers where they can limit and choose feed intake levels. And so as you increase the nutrient level, the density has increased, the feed intake tends to drop, the red line across here, and similarly the FCR, the green line, it will also tend to improve. If you extend this nutrient level table out, you might even see that the FCR might have a J curve where it starts to increase again, get worse because the nutrients are now being overloaded of the gut. And the reddish orange line across the top, this is our profitability line. And we can have a profitability peak. And from that profitability peak is where we determine our nutrient level. And so this is where we start talking about practically, what are our safety margins? Where do we need to be in order to optimize all of these different combinations of costs, nutrient intake, ratios, etc., to give us the best result? And this is where it's very hard to say what is the best diet formulation. To give you an example of this in the poultry world, this is again from the PIC, pig breeding company. And this is just looking at the optimal standard ileal digestibility of lysine for different parameters. If you're trying to maximize performance, the SID lysine value is around 1.28 to 1.42. But it depends on whether you're looking at feed to gain or average daily gain. If you want to use optimize the feed cost per unit gain and therefore minimize your cost, the SID lysine value could be 0.85. And then depending on what your parameter for maximizing profit, again, the SID value is going to vary. And so it's important to understand what your performance objective is and therefore how you apply different formulation approaches and feed additive solutions. So what is the importance of variability in animal production? Well, I'd like to consider two areas here. There's going to be variability in animal growth and all the things that that can impact on, as well as variability in raw materials and the final feed. And once we know that variability exists, we can now try and manage it and reduce its impact. We know that in terms of growth performance, and again, a stylized growth, we know that animals grow slowly at the start and they rapidly accelerate at the end. And if we have any hiccup at the start, then the animal will fall off this optimal curve and start to have these little growth curves like this. And at the end result, every little hiccup means that the animal is now going to be below its par, and small changes at the start of its life will have an impact on its life's performance. For example, that 1 extra kilogram at weaning is 1 week faster to market for pigs. So it's really important to optimize this early gut condition so that we actually have much better performance at the end where the majority of feed is being consumed. This is variability is similar when we start talking about hens, whether these are breeders or layers, because we know that we want to have maximum uniformity, consistency in the flock, because if we have a good uniformity, the birds will respond much better to lighting programs. And this is the optimal area, again, from the Highline Brown, but all of the breeding companies have similar targets. We know, though, that if you get poor uniformity with 60% of the birds in that particular range rather than 80%, then those birds are going to have a wide and variable response to light stimulation, and you won't get optimal performance. So managing variation in animals is really quite important. But what about raw materials? And this is some old data, admittedly, from Keith Benke from KSU in the States. And what's a good data set, because he's looked at the impact across seasons of two major raw materials that we use in our diets, corn and soybean meal. And you can see that there's huge variability in the crude protein across each of those batches, but even year to year. And measuring this sort of the crude protein alone without consideration of amino acids, we still have a huge variation. In this particular data set, minimum protein was 5.1% and maximum was 8.69%. A huge variation there. What value are we taking for our diets? Are we taking one around 6 for the load or one up closer to 8? And the similar variation occurs in soybean meal. In this particular case, over a year's worth of data, 156 different samples, there was a range in 43% to 50% in soybean meal crude protein. And obviously crude protein will have a direct result on the amino acid composition. So what number do we take to use in our formulations? We know that the amino acid requirements for a bird or a pig at a different stage of growth is very precise to 3 or 4 decimal places, but how do we account for that when the variability of our raw materials could be so much? Another good one, again, a little bit old data, but is the impact of dried distillers grains and soluble. And you can see in this particular graph that crude protein varies from as low as 25% up to 31%. Again, including these sort of raw materials in our diets at 10, 15, even 20% will have a big impact on the total amount of energy and amino acid available to our animals. So I'd just like to pause there for a second, and Ron will take over with the first poll question.
Okay, thanks, Neil. So at this point, we would like to ask our live audience via our poll question. So just a reminder, so choose the answer that best fits your scenario. So our first poll question. Okay, here's the first poll question. So when formulating, what aspect is most important for you to optimize gut efficiency? The options are first, use as safety margins to account for inefficiencies. Second, use enzymes. Third, use feed additives. And fourth, all of the above. So when formulating, we'd like to know what aspect is most important for you. So we'll just wait for the answers to in. So once we have more than 50%, so we'll close. So we'll give just more 3 seconds. Okay, so I guess we can close now the poll. Okay, Neil, so I'll share to you the results of our first poll. The most of the answers is with the first one, the use of safety margins to account for inefficiencies, followed by, 58% is all of the above. I cannot see the yellow. Sorry, the winner is the all of the above, followed by the use of safety margins to account for inefficiencies, and only 8% for use of feed additives. So what do you think is the reason for using all of this, Neil, when formulating?
Well, I guess it reinforces the idea that there are a lot of variabilities in our system, and we need to take multiple approaches to try and help us understand and limit that variation. Safety margins are very common. I'm a bit surprised by the low use of enzymes, but maybe that's not the most important one. But certainly I would be surprised if there's any diets out there, both pig, poultry, ruminants, maybe there's aqua people that wouldn't have an enzyme, whether it's a phytase or a carbohydrate enzyme. But the use of enzymes is probably not the primary reason for optimizing gut efficiency. But no, good information. Thank you for responding.
So, Daniel, I'll return to you then. Okay.
Thank you. So now I would like to introduce the concept of nutrient sparing. And I guess if we take it the perfect world and use this little triangle, on the left-hand side here, we have feed going into an animal. On the right-hand side, we have feces out. And obviously the amount of feed is very high. The amount of feces coming out is very low. And so we have almost complete digestion. Along the way, we need to take out some nutrients. And this is for maintenance. This is to enable the animal to walk around, to breathe, to digest the feed. And then there's going to be excess nutrients available after maintenance will be used for growth and reproduction, whether that's the meat, the milk, the eggs, or the fetus. And along the way, hopefully there's very small amount of unproductive purposes, or what we term metabolic losses. However, we don't operate in the perfect world, we operate in the real world. And in the real world, some amount of feed might go in, but we have less digestibility, and so more feces are coming out. And along the way, if you were to look at these bars, the maintenance arrow is the same. But what happens is that the unproductive purposes of metabolic losses component is much bigger. And what that means is it shrinks the amount of nutrient available for growth and reproduction. And it is this shrinkage which we call nutrient sparing. How do we prevent some of these nutrients from, or divert some of these nutrients from the unproductive purposes and put them back into, or spare them so they're available for growth and reproduction? So our focus is on trying to reduce these metabolic losses. And so in terms of a working definition, sparing just simply means freeing up or saving from a particular purpose. And therefore nutrient sparing is applying strategies to optimize the gastrointestinal tract, the GIT, and the metabolic environment to ensure that more nutrients are digested, absorbed, and utilized for productive purposes, with less nutrients being diverted into these unproductive processes or being excreted. And so some of the key causes of metabolic losses are formulation issues. We don't have the right nutrient compositions or the right ingredients are put together. Even the type and quality of the raw materials used, there might be some anti-nutritional factors, some mycotoxins that will have a big impact. Stress and immune system activation, especially bacterial stresses. And these are some of the major components. And of course, we can have combinations and synergisms between these three. So in terms of a graphic, the importance of the gastrointestinal tract can be identified with this, or drive the message home by looking at this sort of scenario and all these hungry dogs. And if we assume that this pot of gruel is the limited daily nutrient supply, if you happen to be the gastrointestinal tract, so this first cute little dog at the front, because you are the gastrointestinal tract, you will get first utilization of the nutrients. And this will include any of the immune responses that's going on in the gut. Because once the nutrients get out of the gut, then they can start circulating around. They can then be used for maintenance, for breathing, for walking, etc. And then there's going to be heat regulation, other activity, fighting, feathering, etc. And eventually, way down the back here, whatever nutrients are left from this daily pot is available for growth and reproduction. And so our job with nutrient sparing is trying to limit the amount of feed that all these dogs in the front of the row get, so that the dogs or the activities at the end that make us money, growth and reproduction, can actually be maximized. And another way of considering this and the importance of maintenance is to look at, in this particular case, the impact on a pig. And we know that at a particular weight, there would be a distribution curve of pigs, and the pigs at the top end, they're probably eating 2.5 kilograms a day. And of that 2.5 kilograms, 0.9 kilograms would be required for maintenance. And that's about 35% of feed intake. So the first 35% of all that this pig eats goes into maintenance, and then you have about 1.6 kilogram available to grow. And in typical fast growing pigs of good genotypes, they might be growing at a kilo a day or more. So the conversion of this excess feed is really close to 1.6 to 1. On the other side, if pigs are limited in their feed intake and can only eat 1.8 kilos, then the animal still needs this 900 grams for maintenance. And if you're only eating 1.8 kilograms, that means that you only have 0.9 kilogram available for growth. And so in this scenario, 50% of the feed is going to maintenance compared to the faster, bigger pig that's able to eat more. And so half of the feed that the animal is eating is available for maintenance, half available for growth. And so it's going to be very inefficient if you keep these pigs growing, and for the same matter, poultry, keep them growing without optimizing their feed intake and their digestive support. So our aim in animal production is to maximize the feed intake, feed efficiency and growth rate, especially in the finisher periods for pigs and poultry, because this is going to minimize your days on feed and the time to market and really drive home your efficiency. So reducing the nutrient quality, reducing the feed intake in the last weeks of your animal's growth is really not the best strategy. Even in these troubled times, we need to get our pigs out as feed efficiently as possible. And we don't want to be having to use more feed for maintenance than they need to. Certainly, we don't want half of the feed that the animal eats going into maintenance. So if we go back to our table, or my table, what we can see here is that when we look at phytogenics, phytogenics have different four factors that impact on gut health. And so this is why phytogenics are commonly used as a strategy to improve animal performance. So what are phytogenics? Again, you've heard all this, so I won't go through in too much detail. They're just functional feed additives of plant origin. They can be herbs and spices, they can be essential oils, or they can be plant extracts. One of the advantages of, or the key property of phytogenic feed additives, are their sensory properties. So that these are things that influence taste, smell, and can support feed intake. When we also look at some of the biological properties, what we're considering here is importantly anti-inflammatory activity, all those things I talked about with the immune system, antioxidant activity, antibacterial activity, antifungal activity, the ability to activate and secrete digestive enzymes, as well as digestive juices. And so again, really multiple facets of phytogenics, but particularly they have a role in anti-inflammatory activity and the immune system. And so all of these activities support digestion. So when we look at the immune response, I'll just quickly go through this graph very quickly. But what we're looking at is that the immune response is really quite complicated. And anything that we can do to reduce the immune response and optimize it, you will improve animal health because vaccines will work better, but you're also reducing this nutrient loss. So phytogenics work together, combining the sensory properties with the biological properties to optimize performance. The product that we talk about at BIOMIN is the Digestrom DC product. And this is our latest innovation in terms of the duplex capsule, the DC part, where we have the appetizing endogenous secretions around the outside of the duplex capsule. Inside it, we have the gut microbiota modulation activities, and these are centered on carvacrol, thymol, and carvone. And then in the premix, we have cinnamon bark, oak bark, and grapeseed, which function as gut protective components. So when we start looking at what are our feed cost management options with Digestrom, Well, there's a couple of different scenarios. This is standard scenario. One is what we would do at the moment. We have our normal feed cost, and on the other side of the equation, the normal feed cost would give normal performance or normal productivity. What we can do if we add an additive such as digesterone, obviously that's going to increase the feed cost, but you should get a improved performance. So what I would like to introduce you today is two different ways of using feed additives. And this is to do a reformulation where we can downspec the diet, and we can, in scenario three here, we can make the diet downspec. So it's now cheaper than the original normal diet, and this will return our performance to normal. Or we can make the diet cost the same, but we can get higher performance. So again, two different options. And it all sounds great in theory, but what have we actually done to demonstrate that this is going to occur? I've got two quick experiments, one here in poultry and one in swine. And in this particular case in poultry, what we had was three different diets where we had the standard formulation, we added the phytogenic feed additive, and we also had the standard diet with antibiotic growth promoters, enteromycin and solanomycin. We then downspec the diet by 5% in both energy and digestible amino acids, and had the same three treatments: the control diet downspec, added digesterone on top, and the antibiotic growth promoters. And what we were interested in is, if you have a downspec diet and add digesterone, will you get the same performance as the normal diet without any additives? And these are the results that we saw. So in this particular case, these SF, this is the standard diets. So the AGP in growth rate was the red bar, the phytogenic was the green bar, and the control is the blue bar. The reduced feed formulation is shown in these three graphs. And what we found was that, yes, if you reduce the feed by 5% in nutrient density, you're going to have an impact on growth rate. And so we did see a drop in performance. What we also saw, though, is that by adding the digesterone, you can return the performance almost back to normal. So a 5% reduction plus the phytogenic feed additive gave us performance back to normal. And so, you can see the importance of optimizing all of those digestive processes, the anti-inflammatory effects, all these sorts of things by using the impact of the phytogenics. And similarly, we saw, same sort of results with the FCR. We see improvement in FCR on the diets over the top, but also we could reduce the impact of the downspecking relative, the digesterone decreased the impact of the downspecking of the diets. If we look at the production index, again, we saw improvements of using poultry digesterone over the top, as well as in the downspec diets. So the conclusion from this trial, and happy to share more detailed information with the audience, is that supplementation of standard diets with digesterone improves growth rate in FCR. This is the over-the-top approach. Down specification of diets reduces broiler performance, as you would expect. If you take 5% of the nutrient out, you should get down a lower performance. But when you add digesterone back, you recover the growth rate, and this is the nutrient sparing effect. I want to talk about a swine trial diet that was done in Australia over summer. So again, under heat stress conditions, the diets were typical grower finisher diets. The pig started at 21 kilograms, was slaughtered at about 100 kilograms at 21 weeks. Large scale commercial piggery, 15 pigs per pen with 9 replicates per treatment. And again, a similar sort of diet control structure. We had the control diets without digesterone, and the control diets plus digesterone. In this particular case, we down specified the diets for 2.5% in both energy and amino acid, and then added the digesterone. And under the conditions that were done in this particular experiment, the down specking saved about $3.50 per ton on the feed price. What we saw was that the control is the blue and the digesterone treated pigs are the red. And in terms of growth rate for those that follow pig performance, 800 grams a day on average from 9 to 21 weeks is a very good growth rate. And yet we were still able to improve that by 40 grams a day using the digesterol. Downspecking the diet as expected slowed the performance, but again, our objective was to see whether downspecking the diet, returning the not the optimizing the gut performance would get us back to the control. And in this particular case, we did, if not exceeded the control performance. So the take-home message from this is that DC power supplementation increased the average daily gain by about 40 grams per day in already fast-growing pigs. And the DC power and the downspec pigs returned the average daily gain to above that of the control. When we looked at the FCR, again, we saw similar improvements. And for those that are familiar with pig performance, a FCR of around 2.2, 2.25 is very good for these, for you know, commercially grown pigs. And yet we were still able to improve that with digesterol over the top formulation, and also coming in when we down specified the diet, we could still get an important improvement in the FCR. And so the take home message here is that DC power supplementation improves FCR in both groups and in already very efficient pigs. And finally, looking at the carcass weight, this is what we're interested in pig production. We want to sell meat. And what we found was that in combination of feed intake and digestibility improvement, we ended up with nearly 3 kilogram increase in carcass weight on the over-the-top situation and nearly 2 kilograms in the downspec situation. And depending on the current prices for pig meat, this resulted in a return on investment of over 10 to 1, depending on your price of pigs. In terms of back fat, so we measure P2. P2 is the depth of back fat over a particular part of the ribs, and we saw no differences in performance. What we're aiming for is to be under 12 in the market that these pigs were grown in. Back fat thickness of 12 is the target to be under. And so we saw no differences in back fat and with no negative effects on body fat, but with more muscle, the pigs were now much more valued in the payment grid because they were heavier pigs, less fat, more muscle, more value to the meat processor. So where does this all leave us in terms of matrix values for phytogenics? It's an often asked question, and unfortunately the answer is no, we can't use a matrix value for phytogenics. And hopefully the previous discussion has indicated why that is the case. Unlike enzymes, there is not a clear substrate that phytogenics are working on. If you use a phytase molecule or a phytase enzyme, you're working particularly on phytate. If you're using a glucanase, beta-glucanase, you're trying to work on the beta-glucans or xylanases. But with phytogenics, there's not a clear substrate. We might be stimulating digestive enzymes, we might be improving gut integrity, mucin, we might be having a big impact on the anti-inflammatory effects of the gut. So there's no clear substrate that you can actually apply a valid mathematical matrix. And for those that aren't aware, the way that most diets such as phytase and xylanases are used is that people would apply a mathematical uplift to take account of the variation or the improvement in performance that the enzyme will deliver. That's what I mean by talking about a matrix value. And as described here, and I mentioned just again, phytogenics work on many different aspects of gut health and improvement. And depending on your level of digestive stress, what is your major driver, the response is going to be a little bit different for each particular situation. And so that's where a standard matrix is not a valid or scientific approach to apply. What we can do though, based on the trials that we've done, the two that I shared with you, but others, our approach is to start and reduce the energy and amino acid content of the diet by at least 2, if not 2.5%. And at this level, try it on your operations, get a feel for the performance that comes from that, and then you can start to increase that up to maybe 3, 3.5%, which many of our other customers have done. Just in terms of this matrix value, I just wanted to share with you a trial that was done in Australia, admittedly with wheat, but just showing the variability in why using enzymes with an automatic uplift can be a dangerous thing. In this particular example that was done in pigs, but the work has also been replicated in poultry with other grains, you can see that with no enzyme is the yellow bars, but with plus enzyme is the red bar, and we're looking at average daily gain. And depending on what variety of wheat was being fed to these pigs, some pigs responded to the enzyme, other pigs didn't respond. And so if you put a standard matrix value into your formulation and you weren't aware at the time what your wheat or corn variety that you received was, you would be giving your diets an artificial uplift that would not be reflected in the animal performance. And so therefore, it's quite risky to have uplifts for carbohydrate enzymes if you don't know what the underlying performance is. And my recommendation is that ideally you should only use an enzyme as an insurance to deliver the expected energy value of your grain in your matrix. So whatever energy is in your grain, that's what an enzyme will ensure you will get out of that particular grain. You won't get a much higher value on a regular basis. So on that note, I'd like to now move into the second poll question, Ron. Ron?
Oh, from our live audience, if nutrient-sparing, hello?
We can hear you, just need to share the screen. Yeah.
Hi, Neil. Yep. Okay. So at this point, we would like to know with our
question.
Yes, we'll be with the poll question. So we would like to know if nutrient sparing is ever practiced in your organization. So here's the poll question. So is nutrient sparing ever practiced in your work organization? Options are never, rarely, only after trials are run. Yes, with some success. Or yes, but with little success. So we urge everybody to let us know if you ever practice nutrient sparing. Oh, the votes are really coming faster right now. So let's see. So let's give 5 more seconds to give everybody chance to vote. Okay. Okay, so I'm closing now the poll and then I'm sharing now the answers. And the answer that we got is the 55%, they rarely practice nutrient sparing only after trials are run. That's 55% meal, followed by with the tie at 18%, both with yes with some success and yes with but with little success. So that's 18% both. And then only 9% with never.
Okay. Now that's good information to know that people are, you know, already generally aware of the nutrient sparing approach. And you know, I guess as a Biomin person, we need to help customers understand why the trials might not have worked, and you know, give some assurity as to how to make sure that they work on a bit more of a regular basis. So thank you very much for those that responded. So almost in the home straight now, and again, talking about, you know, consistency with performance that the poll sort of identified, I'd like to share with you some of the data around the, you know, it's not a meta-analysis because we haven't done thousands of trials, but just to give you a bit of an idea about when we use phytogenics, particularly the digesterone products, are the results consistent? And this is just a summary of 17 different trials where we use digesterone in broilers. And what we found was that on average, when we looked at final body weight, FCR, and the European efficiency factor, that we improved final body weight by 3.7%, FCR was improved by 4.6%, and the efficiency factor was improved by nearly 10%. And so, from my technical perspective, I could show you all of these trials individually. But depending on what your performance parameters were, you might discount some of these trials because you didn't get, in this trial two, you didn't get a big improvement in final body weight. But even without a big improvement in body weight, there was still improvements in FCR and the efficiency went up. And so I think sharing these sorts of slides give you some confidence that digesterone results are consistent. When we start looking at broilers, at weaners rather, looking at the digesterone performance in weaners. This is a summary of 50 trials. Again, some trials had good average daily gains. Some trials had slight reductions in average daily feed intake, much better improvement in FCR. And across all of the board, what we find is we get an improvement in about 5% in average daily gain, improvement of about 1% in feed intake, and improvement of nearly 4% in terms of FCR. So again, quite consistent trials when you look at across all of the quite consistent performance when you look across 50 trials. When we start looking at digesterone in grower finisher pigs, again, 19 trials here, average daily gain in blue, average daily feed intake in green, and FCR. And on average, we get, again, 4.7% improvement in average daily gain, a 1% improvement in feed intake, and a 3% reduction in FCR. And depending on the type of trial conditions, some of these pigs might have already got to gut fill, so you couldn't eat more feed. Some of them might have had different challenges. But overall, if you look at the number of trials that have been done, you can see that the performance with using digesterone are going to lead to a positive return on investment in your farms. So in conclusion, Mr. Chairman, what I wanted to do in this seminar is hopefully give you a bit of an idea that formulating for gut health may be just as important as getting the amino acid and energy ratios just right, because there's a degree of variability that just doesn't maybe allow us to get those energy ratios just right, but there's a big impact of not getting gut health right. Variation and metabolic losses are inherent in an animal production systems. We can't minimize that to zero, but certainly if we have some knowledge of the impact of variation and the role it has in metabolic losses, then we can improve our animal performance. And we know that variation starts early in life, and therefore all efforts should be made to minimize the impact of variation for the life of the animal. And this is where we have some flexibility, for the first starter diets, booster diets, for the first 7 to 10 days, really spending a lot of money in terms of nutrient composition, supporting additives to really maximize the growth of those animals, optimize the microbiota so that those animals are well set up for long periods of efficient growth. Also, hopefully this seminar has enabled you to that consideration of nutrient sparing approaches, such as the use of phytogenic feed additives, should increase animal performance and profitability, and even in these challenging times, and to some extent are probably more important when people aren't making as much money as they hoped, and you don't want to be wasting those valuable and expensive feeds due to shortage in supply and things. And so there's an opportunity for maximizing your returns, minimizing your losses by the use of appropriate feed additives. And with that, I open now the floor to any questions. Thank you very much for your attendance, and I look forward to answering all your challenging questions. Over to you, Ron. Hello, Ron. Oh, that's not a good sign when we've lost our chairperson. Unfortunately, I can't see any of the questions that might be there.
Hello.
Hey, Ron, you're back again.
Hello, Neil, can you hear me?
I can hear you. We can't see you, but I'm happy to take questions now.
Yes. Okay. Okay. So we received several questions. I'll combine some questions. There's a question, how long can you implement nutrient sparing to avoid performance dips? And is it effective for a particular stage like growing or finished stage or younger bird or younger stage?
Yep. Good, excellent question. The ideal time is in the grower finisher phases. In terms of nutrient sparing, you should not be nutrient sparing using too many approaches to nutrient spare in the first developmental diets of both pigs and poultry. because those animals are using, or those diets are typically using, high quality raw materials that are already digestible. The challenges in this early stage of growth is feed intake. So we should be maximizing feed intake, because the biological ability of the animal is, if you get the right feed into the animals and it's highly digested, the animals will grow very fast and perform quite close to their genetic potential. So we shouldn't be restricting any feed intake or you know, use of poor raw materials in the early stages, the first 14 days of a broiler's life, the first couple of weeks of a pullet rearer, or the first couple of weeks of piglets. But once you've got good gut health established, and for example, from 14 days onwards to slaughter in poultry, or from point of when the pigs leave the weaning shed at 9 or 10 weeks of age, this is the ripe opportunity where we're now starting to use more cheaper, more variable raw materials, more byproducts, and this is where the biggest opportunity occurs. Because phytogenics or any other feed additive strategy takes a couple of weeks for the gut to be optimized, because we're looking at anti-inflammatory approaches, we're looking at gut integrity, all of these biological processes can take several days, if not weeks, to be optimized. It's recommended to use a nutrient sparing approach for the long period. You don't just sort of turn it on and turn it off, because week on, week off does not give enough time for the animal to adapt and the inherent biochemical mechanisms to adapt. So once you start from the grower diets, it's a good process to finish it all the way through to slaughter.
I see. So Neil, there's a question. What criteria should we have in choosing a good nutrient sparing feed additive? What are the criteria if we will choose a nutrient sparing additive, food feed additive?
Well, the important part is understanding what the feed additive, and as I mentioned in that table, there's four different aspects of gut health. And so it's important to understand what your additive is going to do, and obviously the science and other data that goes behind that, demonstrating that the additive is going to be effective for the intended application. And then you can start to choose, well, within your own operation, am I challenged because of heat stress and perhaps feed intake? And heat stress also has a big impact on gut integrity. So is that the challenge to my operation? Am I using, poor quality raw materials that are high in molds and mycotoxins and other things? And so reducing the impact of mycotoxins might be a starting point. So understanding what it is that your animals are suffering from, and that can also change as the animals get older. It could be a stocking density problem, it could be a wet litter problem, it could be environmental problem in terms of humidity. So understanding what is the driver around feed intake, and then adapting your chosen strategy, depending on your solutions. So that would be some of the tips that I would be looking at. But furthermore, I'd sort of, if you do start using some of these alternative raw materials, the byproducts, DDGS, other corn byproducts, rice byproducts, it's really important to get a good understanding of the variability that's inherent in the nutrient content of those raw materials, so that when you include those in your diet, you have a good handle, not only on the total content, but the digestible content of amino acids, energy, etc. Because this is going to be the biggest impact on your performance.
Okay. Neil, let me read two more questions. So the second to the last is, aren't phytogenic oils sensitive to heat? How will we know if this will retain after pelleting? So
yes,
mostly on heat stability of essential oils.
Yeah, and this is a very common question and a good observation that, yes, essential oils are volatile. We know they're volatiles because you smell them. In our homes, we often have essential oil burners where we have candles and pure drops of things. So we know that essential oils are volatile. And this is where, in the particular case of Biomin, our development of the DC capsule, it's a matrix type approach that protects the essential volatile oils from damaging through the gut and the acid conditions in the stomach, as well as the effects of the pelleting through the pelleting mill, and allows them to be delivered sustainably over the gut where they're needed. And so this is, yeah, it's the encapsulation technology is really the key driver or the key assessment in working out if the phytogenic feed additive is going to work or not. So it's the encapsulation that makes it heat stable, but you don't want something that's completely heat stable if it doesn't then actually become available in the gut where it's needed and it gets excreted straight out still in its heat stable form. So there's a whole lot of technology and science that goes behind making a product that's heat stable, protected from the stomach, but then able to have its effect on the small intestine where it's most needed.
Yeah. So Neil, there's a question about ractopamine.
Yes. Sorry, Ron, you've
just... Digesterone be applicable in diet with ractopamine? Will it not have issues if used together?
No. No problem so with using ractopamine.
About using ractopamine with digesterone.
Yep, no problem with using ractopamine. And in fact, the experiment I showed in Australia, those pigs were all actually on ractopamine for the last 21 to 28 days. So the differences between ractopamine and phytogenics, there's a different mode of action rather, but more importantly, with ractopamine, you need to upspec the diet. You need to give the animal more amino acids. So if the ractopamine is improving muscle deposition, then you need to have more amino acids in the diet. And this is why digesterone and ractopamine can be used in combination, because you are improving the digestibility, the gut conditions, the reduction in anti-inflammatory properties, etc. All of these will allow more nutrients to be available to allow the ractopamine to perform. But equally, we've done many experiments, and many people are now not allowed to use ractopamine or choose not to use ractopamine, and we're seeing, particularly in the US, great sales growth with the phytogenics, because they're getting the same, the farmers are getting the same performance in the swine with phytogenics, digesterone from the grower period, if not in the weaner period, all the way through to the end of growth, compared to just using the ractopamine for the last 28 days. So yes, phytogenics can be used in combination with ractopamine, or they can be a alternative to ractopamine. And somewhat as an alternative, it's a much easier process because you don't have to change the diet for the last 4 weeks of life. And if you don't change the diet but put ractopamine in, there's a risk that you're spending a lot of money on the product but not getting the performance in the pigs that the ractopamine can deliver.
Yeah. So, Neil, two more questions came in. So, would you advise nutrient sparing in layers and breeding animals?
You can. Breeding animals, depending on the raw materials, often the breeder animals are fed a higher quality diet, but also certainly broiler breeders and layer breeders are restrictively fed. So the phytogenics can certainly have an approach there, but in this particular case, the phytogenics are best used over the top. If you're using high amounts of byproducts or raw materials that you're not sure of the quality of, this is probably the better opportunity for using the nutrient sparing approach in terms of a down spec. But nutrient sparing as a concept is applicable in terms of improving all of the digestibility of the material and improving gut health. So phytogenics over the top is a very solid strategy for pullet rearers, laying hens and breeding hens all the way through. I probably wouldn't recommend down-specking in those situations because of the different drivers that you're trying to achieve in those particular production systems. But over-the-top approach and allowing the digesterone to maximize the nutrient availability in all of those raw materials is a very sound approach.
Okay, Neil, so we are down with the last question. Phytogenics are usually associated with improving feed intake. Will they help in hot conditions?
Yes, yep, they do. And that's one of the, as mentioned, the flavor component of the phytogenics is one of the key things. And certainly in the summertime in Australia with the digesterone trial, we saw more uniform intake and higher intakes. So yes, using these flavoring agents is a good strategy. The other component to heat stress is that animals don't want to eat, and they tend to eat at night or in the cooler conditions if they're allowed to have air conditioning of some description. And so when you're having these sudden bursts of intake, then this can overload the digestive capacity of the gut. And this is where some support, like as a phytogenic, can help improve feed intake and digestibility, and therefore reduce some of the heat increment that comes from eating feed in the heat time. So yeah, phytogenics for feed intake, but also if they improve digestibility, there's more feed can go through the pipe. And so this digestion improvement by itself can also lead to better feed intake. So there's two aspects of feed intake: improved digestibility and better transit time, and also absolute flavoring.
Okay, so that was so many questions. So thanks, Neil, for answering all of them. So at this point, we would like to thank you, Neil, and also a reminder for our live audience that we urge you to take our post survey after this webinar. So your feedback is very important to us, and we would like to know how to improve this support to you. So at this point, in behalf of BIOMIN Philippines, we would like to thank everybody for participating in our second webinar of BIOMIN Philippines. So thank you so much. So thank you so much, and have a great afternoon, everybody. Keep safe. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye.